Good morning, everybody. By the time presentation is up, I just want to say that it's my privilege to be here in IIT Gandhinagar. This is for the first time I'm here. In fact, I came to Gujarat in 2003 when I was doing a study for Saki Waters to look at what our educational system is having to offer for the kids with respect to water resources management. So as part of that project, I visited IIM and several other institutions in Gujarat. Here for the first time, delighted to be here and very impressed with the campus and several other things which I have noticed yesterday evening and today morning. I have visited several IITs and I must say that this is one of the best ones. So I'll be talking about water resources. There is a talk in the evening also which will be much more detailed around multidisciplinarity about water resources management and all, but right now I'll be focusing more on two things. One is that how big or how severe the issue is, the stress is to all of us, and what we can do as a society, and what are the things which we need to look at, and what is that we can contribute to. So it actually gets into some of the work which we as an organization, WWF, is doing in some parts of the country, not so much in Gujarat in terms of water resources, but our species and landscape team is very much active in loin conservation, as well as our marine team is quite active over here. So these are some basic figures coming from Central Water Commission or Ministry of Water Resources, and pretty much all of you are aware about it. What I want to stress over here is one thing, which is bullet point number three, which is to say that our per capita water availability is going down and down and down, and in last six decades it has declined by 70%. And with this kind of use and the kind of practices we have, it is going to have a huge problem for not only for us but also for the life on the planet as well as within the country. And whatever water resources we have, about 60% of that is falling within Ganga, Brahmaputra and Meghna basins. So there is a huge variance in terms of availability of water resources spread across the country. On the top of it, we know that population is growing, there are competing demands, there is irrigation, there is domestic, there is industrial supplies, and irrigation being the topper in that. So the first question which comes to our mind, if I talk about conservation of freshwater resources, which include rivers and wetlands and others, is the how the community or the society wanted to see their river. In what way they want to see their river? Do they want to see it as a trickle of water or of a wastewater, or they want to see their river as a freshwater resource which is a mighty and a healthy river system? If you want to see your river system as a healthy and a mighty river system, then what are the things you or society needs to do? And what are the activities that can be and should be discouraged? This led to emergence of some of the, you know, disciplines within the environmental sciences, or you say water resources management, which is now kind of some of them are already there, being researched, being practiced, and some are kind of upcoming fields, and it's up for the researchers or the academia community to look at. One of the things which we have been working, or several institutions are part of that, is looking at the issue of flows. And now that has come or become an issue because of the alterations in the hydrological systems that we are doing, because of infrastructure projects and because of other dams and barrages. Second thing is related to pollution or related to deteriorating health of the river systems or of the wetlands. So if that is happening, then how do we do the assessment of our river health? And how do we do the assessment of our wetlands health? What are the tools, what are the ways and means through which we can do, and by doing so, how we can contribute? The third important thing, which is not in the discussion several years back, but now it has become very, very critical, to understand surface water, groundwater interaction. It's a very complex subject in itself, and not many people has worked on it. And of course, Government of India has recently started a program around this, to look at this surface water groundwater interaction at a country scale. But again, it's a long way to go, complex science involved in it. And again, it has hydrology, it has geology mixing together and coming out with the product. So I'll try to spend maybe just 1 minute on each of the last three things which I just shared in the previous slide that, okay, in order to take care of the hydrological regimes which are being impacted because of abstractions or diversions, what is that we can do? We can ensure or we can work towards maintaining the river systems in a way that it is able to sustain the processes and functions which are due from a river. It can, it should be able to survive the wildlife, it should be able to survive the aspirations of the people who visit the river or reside close to the rivers. So we call it environmental flows. So the kind of need is that, okay, rivers need to maintain the environmental flows downstream of such infrastructures or such projects. In a sense that it has desired flows or flow patterns during dry and wet seasons, so that it can remain a living entity, it can remain a healthy entity, and it can provide its services to the society and to the nature for the times to come. And when we talk about environmental flows, now there are different ways to interpret it. The way we look at it is that it's not only the water in the river is all about the key component of river, but there are several associated aspects, processes, and functions which needs to be taken into account while doing any sort of assessment of environmental flows. So it's very much there in the slide, so I won't get into the details of that right now. I'll move to the next one, which is a kind of a flow regime which we recommend as part of our assessment exercise. And we would then say that, okay, this is the kind of flow regime which should be maintained for a given river, for a given site, and for a given season. This is just one example from one of the study which we did for Ramganga River in Uttarakhand and UP. This site is in Moradabad city, and this is just to explain you how it works and how one can interpret it. So the green line on the top of is basically the calculated flows or the naturalized flows, which is based on precipitation in that area. The second blue dotted line is what is recommended by the multidisciplinary group who actually studied all the aspects which I described in the previous slide to come out with the kind of flow requirement during different months or different seasons. The yellow line is actually the flow which is right now there in the river, kind of an observed flow right now. Then there is a red line which is a drought year scenario, if there is a drought year, but still there are certain basic functions of the river systems which are required to be maintained. So that sort of flow recommendation is there. So that's one way of representing how environmental flows can be presented. Second thing, and another important thing, is to understand the river health in a holistic way. You can see the round in the center with RHI written on it. It has five components. It has catchment health assessment, it has channel and flow health assessment, it has water quality health assessment, it has biota health assessment, and it has community perception. Together, all these five components contribute to the overall river health index for that given site of a river system. So it's just an example from the work we are doing in Ganga and Ramganga river systems. There are around 10 groups we have created at different locations in the Ganga and Ramganga. The blue one is Ganga and the gray one is Ramganga. So the idea is that these groups are kind of a multidisciplinary group in nature, in the sense that there are people from farming background, there are villagers, there are teachers, there are students, there are government employees, there are advocates, there are industrialists also as part of those groups in these locations. They basically, together with us, do the river health assessment on their own. And with the support, they also try to develop a report card of river health of that specific location. And the idea is that once you develop that report card, you then present it to the local authorities to explain it to them that river which is flowing in front of us is in this state. What we can do to take it to the better level or improved level. So we have used very simple traffic light kind of indicators to show whether the river is good, bad, or poor. Third thing which I talked about is the assessment of losing and gaining nature of streams, which is the interface between surface and groundwater. This is one of the work which we did in Ramganga Basin, looking at the main stem and some of the key tributaries, and then try to identify okay, where the river is feeding the groundwater and where the groundwater is feeding the river. It's very important to understand, because at the end of the day, when you wanted to do an intervention with respect to enhancing flows in a river system or with respect to maintaining a reasonably good groundwater level, you need to first understand this. You then identify your location for intervention, and that is the kind of a starting point to go for an intervention. But there are, at the moment, there are very few studies like this one, but this to me is the need of an hour. Okay, so the next generation question, the one which we discussed earlier, is a kind of a primary question that, okay, how we want to see our rivers, our wetlands, our water bodies. Now, if at all they need to be revived, from where the water will come? We know that water, our river systems are committed, or you can say overcommitted, but if at all you need to bring water back into the system, from where the water will come? This needs to take into account the action or, you know, the kind of commitment at both the levels, both at rural as well as at urban level. I'll first talk about something around irrigation water use efficiency. This is there since 1999 or maybe before that, when National Commission on Integrated Water Resources Development started talking about it and said that we need to increase our water use efficiency across all sectors by 20%. It's been more than a decade, or I think 15 years or so. We are nowhere close to what we said at that point of time. But it's definitely needed if at all we want to revive our water systems. So we need to talk about water use efficiency at multiple levels. One is at the levels where the river basins or the farm area is having surplus water resources, but still, since the diversions are happening, rivers are still under stress. So that's the places where you can start introducing these activities. Then there is another set. I'll also give the example later on of that kind of areas. Then there is another set of example where there is scarcity already evident. And then what do you do? So the photo with the tractor you are seeing is from Bijnor in UP. It's a pure sugarcane belt area, and flooding is predominant when it comes to irrigating the farmlands. So what is being done here is that with the help of a trencher, it's kind of a tool which you put behind the tractor, and then it will create these furrows. And then by doing this itself, we are making an effort to save around 35 to 40% of water in the command of that specific area. Whereas in other two photographs, these are coming from Tamil Nadu, which is a totally kind of a water deficient area. And farmers have really gone ahead in terms of water use efficiency. They talk about drip irrigation. They talk about sheet mulching and things like that. But again, its coverage is something which is still one can work on. Like maybe 20, 30% of farmers or 40% of farmers are doing it, but you still need to take it to 80% or 90%. So this kind of work needs to be done at both the levels and in both kind of scenarios. Then coming to the water footprint calculations. Now this is more towards the cities and urban people. We also run a kind of campaign called Water Footprint Campaign in cities like Moradabad, Bareilly and others, where we try to educate the people as along with the Nagar Palika or Nagar Nigams to talk about their daily water use practices and how they can minimize that. This to me is an essential part of education, which needs to be done at right from the school level within the cities and within the towns. It's important. I have seen something similar happening here also in IIT, which I was very happy about. And eventually, whatever we have described so far in the presentation or discussed, why we are doing it? One is that these activities need to be checked, but for whom? These activities need to be checked for the people and for the life in the river systems, in the freshwater ecosystems, and the wetlands. Thank you very much, and I look forward to the questions. Sure.